This is Tom Gebhardt, and some of you may know him in different contexts, and he's actually been a presenter in the religion forum over the past few years, giving to us his answer to the topic from an atheist perspective. And so Tom and I, for example, have counterpointed, and a few of the rest of you in the room have also asked him questions as an atheist. And he's here to tell us his story. And the topic for tonight is spiritual conversion. And I don't know what you think about conversion, but I wanted to say right up front that we are not saying tonight, and it especially is the Christian view at least, that conversion, an individual conversion, or a mass conversion even, is not proof that a particular religious system is true. We live in a world that is quite transient. There's a lot of what may appear to be conversion happening back and forth. And if you want to Google that as a topic, you can find out that there are a lot of people who are confused about their spirituality today. They view themselves to be thoroughly spiritual, and they're on paths, and they're going from A to B, and some go from B to A. So that's a little bit of the story that's before us tonight, and it should help us as you're listening to Tom, along with me, as we're listening to Tom and his story, to think about what you believe about conversion. I would say that largely Christians believe that conversion to faith in Jesus is a work of God alone, that it's something that happens to us. And as far as I understand secularist positions, conversion would be human rationalism in its complete free form, so that a secularist would say, I have chosen to convert. Whereas a Christian would say, God worked conversion in me. So those are probably the two polar opposites that may be in the room. But if you're a card-carrying Oregonian, you're probably right now trying to think of a third or fourth or seventh classification. So be my guest. Come up with one of those others. But those are the two polar opposites as far as I can tell. All right, so it's my privilege to interview Tom tonight. I've enjoyed my friendship building with Tom over the last few years, not only on this stage, but out to coffee or online. And Tom, I have a few questions that you and I have gone over so that you can tell it. You're not nervous, are you? Good, all right. All right, just be yourself. So tell us about your childhood years, Tom. Growing up as a Christian, were you more of a cultural Christian? Or did you experience spiritual transformation in those early years? What were some of the spiritual pivotal moments during those years? Tell us a little bit about your childhood.
Well, I was born on the sand dunes of the Idaho desert. Was there until I was age six in Boise, Idaho. I moved to Alaska. I first accepted Christ in my heart when I was six. But you'll hear the story about a lot of Christians where they didn't feel that they understood enough of the relationship with God as a child at that time. So when I was nine, I felt I understood things. I understood the work of God in my life better and rededicated my heart to the Lord. Was baptized when I was 15 as a witness to the Holy Spirit's work in my life. So what's the question specifically?
Right. So during those years, were you more of a cultural Christian, or did you experience some real spiritual transformation?
I was definitely not a cultural Christian, I felt like I really did have a sincere relationship with God. It was a very personal thing to me. I enjoyed going and having devotionals out in nature. I found that being in nature was a mode of getting closer to God for me. And I felt, I also noticed that even from an early age, I was very sensitive to the way other Christians would be around me. Whether that was, you know, someone that I admired as a Christian, or noticing some form of hypocrisy. So I kind of had a sensitivity, even from a young age, to the way that the church was that I was in, the community aspect of it. There was a lot of pivotal moments for me growing up. I was involved in a lot of Bible studies. I was in Bible quizzing, where you compete on verses of the Bible. It was kind of a memory exercise. And I did some working witness missions and things like that. And so I had a very engaged, upbringing. Cultural doesn't really, I probably didn't even understand what culture meant growing up. It just felt like a way of life towards, for me, it was very engaging. And there was many pivotal moments. Some were, a lot of them, as youth Christians will testify to, there's a lot of really Christian youth events where, you're seeing 5,000 people are singing and our God is an awesome God. And the spiritual moments that one has being amongst thousands and thousands of people, those left some deep impressions on me. But again, it wasn't the big things that were pivotal moments for me. It was more of the personal things that involved solitude and the world, being in the background and one really digging with what you understood God, as a young person growing up, and just getting closer to God. Those were definitely important moments.
So Tom, how old were you when you left your Christian faith behind and started to pursue atheism?
I think that was around 28 years of age. It was mid-2002. Looking back, I looked at a lot of things that may have contributed to my wanting to step outside the church, my wanting to question things. For example, as if people are looking for a correlation with when I stepped out, you also had 9/11, that was 6 months prior to that, mid-2002 experience, and a lot of people woke up during that time where we're a lot more introspective, and there's a lot, there's a lot more vulnerability. People, the country felt vulnerable. Things that led, I think, to stepping out and, inquiring outside of the church were my family upbringing. There were things that I never had really gotten to the bottom of with my family. It was kind of turbulent. And so, that leaves an obvious impression on someone growing up, because you have a dysfunctional family on the outside, but then you go through the doors of the church and you're supposed to have it more together. And the church, unfortunately, the churches that I went to wasn't a culture of transparency and people truly, talking. And so I saw that duplicity, and I think that in its own way had an emotional and psychological impact on me. There's other reasons as well. One is journaling. I recommend journaling to everyone. I started that in around year 2000, just really getting who I was and my thoughts and fears and pain out onto a page, just to really frame who I was as a person. That led to a lot of questioning. But I do feel that stepped outside the church, I kind of threw out the baby with the bathwater. The things that I didn't like in church, I threw out. But with that, there was other things that I no longer was paying as much attention to or didn't see as valid. I just wanted to be this more of this just pure inquirer who was neutral. But looking back, I underestimated how profound a lot of these things were in my life. That I don't know if you really can be neutral in the way that I intended.
So when you became an atheist, was there some evidence or major questions posed by natural science or philosophy that caused you to doubt your Christian faith, or were conclusive in your mind as proof that atheism was the better worldview and lifestyle?
Well, that's a very good question.
Well, it's your question.
That's what I do.
Yeah.
That's what you do, Tom.
Yeah, that's right. The questions I'm asking Tom are ones that we worked through that he gave to me. So, sound familiar, Tom?
Well, there's just there's a lot of things. When I look back, I did about 8 years of reading popularized science books and journaling and participating in philosophy debates and just really trying to be honest in where I was going or what I was still restless about, not settled about. One that comes to mind of a piece of evidence back then that gave me some, you could say, doubt that I could not shake off was a book by Matthew Alper called The God Part of the Brain. I read it in early 2004, and I didn't actually acknowledge that I was in the camp of an atheist until early 2006. So this was 2 years before that. And it basically talked about that there's an area of the brain that lights up when people are having a meditative experience, when they are praying. And so that is a God part of the brain. That's a gross summary of that book. And I remember asking myself for the first time, why does what should be an exclusively supernatural phenomenon, why does that have a physical basis? Why is there an area of the brain that seems to light up when one is having a spiritual experience? The premise of the book was they would take people and they would hook them up to an MRI, a brain scan, and that there would be an area of the brain that would light up. So that was an example. To me, that got me asking other questions. If that's the situation, what else might be the situation? Some classic ones like, why is there so much pain and suffering in the world? If there is a good God, why does he allow those things? One was with the Michael Behe that you could say irreducible complexity. It's just a lot of interesting scientific things that were questions that I debated with other secularists at the time.
Right. So let's see. What were the circumstances or questions that triggered your pilgrimage back to Christianity from atheism?
What were some of the things that triggered those?
Yeah. So you had some of this compounding evidence. You had some questions like the problem of pain and suffering. So then from 2006 to, 2011? So for about 5 years, you were a cart-carrying atheist?
Until late 2011. Some of the things that caused me to start moving back, it's just such a huge question. That's why I had to really take it in, because it's just, this is not a presentation, this is an interview, and it's over very, very personal things. I was definitely really involved in the secular community. One, you may have heard of it, CFI Portland. It was my intention to build a secular community It started in 2008, and I thought at the time I was still a secularist, that I could create a secular alternative, equivalent, of what you find in dynamic communities and churches and things like that. And it took several years for me to realize that we were not coming even close to creating a secular alternative, that there were some things that were fundamentally missing in the secular community, in my opinion. That area, things in the area of relationships, accountability, the power of narrative, let alone the need for faith and spirituality, those things were not really brought up. And so it took several years for me to realize that this was not, there was something fundamentally not there. And so it started giving me, allowing me to look at the validity, the relevance of church again. And so I started paying more attention to the way that churches are. I started blogging about it, doing blog posts. And, it's just very, it's just kind of a very personal journey of moving towards faith. I wanted to make sure that I wasn't doing what I felt other secularists around me were doing, and that was to just intellectually approach Christians. I wanted to be that anthropologist. A lot of us respect anthropologists. They go to a tribe, for example, and they interact with people whose beliefs may really go against the fact, their belief system, and there's the temptation to react to that. But I wanted to be that anthropologist to really listen and learn. I didn't believe in my mind back then, I didn't believe Christianity so I could continue to be dogmatic and reactionary. I wanted to be neutral. And so that idea of the anthropologist. And so I found myself blogging and now starting to attend churches. And it took being there for me to start realizing there were things that I had thrown out with the bathwater, as I was saying earlier. And so I continued to write about that, and I continued to see, and with that, my secular worldview, I made the decision, you could say, of atheism, but I had a secular ethical worldview of secular humanism. And that's supposed to be a worldview that helps you find meaning, to make purpose in your life. It's supposed to answer ethical and moral questions. But I was finding that even that worldview, let alone science, was addressing what would be my metaphysical questions. What I mean by metaphysical is most of us have two ways of looking at reality. One is through an objective or a scientific worldview. We understand that this table is composed of certain things, and so we look at it through a rational viewpoint. But we also have a metaphysical or an existentialist viewpoint that you can't address with science. It's about the deeper questions, a lot of them abstract, so many having to do with faith, love, relationships, spirituality, that are realities that may be abstract and not a hard science, but are nevertheless just as important of a reality to us. It resonates in us just as much as, say, the hard sciences or biology. And so we have these two realities. And I found out that my secular worldview was not addressing any of those questions, such as how am I really going to live out the rest of my life in a way that is meaningful and fulfilling. And I didn't, even though I had read a lot of books and understood a lot of about how the way the world works, none of that was touching upon my metaphysical needs, the big questions. And so those were, to summarize, what caused me to continue moving forward I was still restless. I knew that there were things that I had not truly gotten to the bottom of, and it continued to push me forward.
Let's see, looking back, how do you view the quality of life you had as an atheist compared to the quality of life you have as a Christian?
Today?
Today.
That's a really good question.
It's yours.
At first, I had an honest intention to freely inquire when I was outside the church, from mid 2002 to about early 2012, I wanted to do it with logic and reason, and I wanted to be a free inquirer. I wanted to explore and to be open to everything. And so I began elevating freedom to do whatever I want, because that's being a free inquirer. That's being open-minded. And it sounds very attractive on the face of it. But freedom does carry with it a lot of consequences. In the way that it's interesting how our minds are built. On the one hand, our minds love freedom. On the other hand, we need structure, we need rules. When we have too much of something, in excess, that can lead to consequences. And so my secular life, I didn't give a lot of thought to some of the consequences of me now being free and, quote, liberated to do what I wanted to do. There was some freedom, but there was also a lessening of discipline, a lessening of introspection, of humility. There was an increase in control, because the person may appear, I may have appeared to be very, analyzing this and that, but that can also be a way of, I want to understand this, I want to be in control. I feel like today, the contrast to that is that I have a much deeper understanding of consequences, just having walked that road, there's a lot that you have to recover from, because I exposed myself to a lot. And Christ asks us to focus on Him and to deny ourselves and to really listen to the Holy Spirit. It's no longer really the highest principle in my life, freedom. It's learning, it's growing, it's being introspective, it's being willing to change and learn. That's a good summary of it so far.
So are there aspects in your present relationship with God today that are different from the Christianity you experienced as a child for the first 28 years of your life?
Yeah, there are some definite, some small but significant differences. One would be that my relationship with God, I understand more of who I am as a person. When you're growing up in Christianity, you still got to grow up. You still got to figure out who you are. You got to understand the underlying reasons. Issues that one might have may not be the real issue. There might be underlying issues. For example, you hear often, if you've ever looked into it, that a person may not be having an addiction with alcoholism, that's the main issue, that there are underlying issues, but there are the real problem, not the alcoholism itself. And you can't learn that growing up in your Christianity. And so just a deeper understanding of myself, and just a deeper understanding of who God is, his nature. I don't feel like I'm answering that question very well. well, let me percolate more on that as the evening goes on. Because that's a deep question, and there are some real significant changes that have happened. A lot of it still is relatively recent, some of the changes. Though it did start, it's been happening for about a year and a half now.
Yeah, I think everything you're saying so far, I can imagine that you're allowing the audience to formulate quite a few questions. Mm-hmm. So they're going to get their moment here. Are you ready for that?
Absolutely.
Yeah, so before I throw you to the dogs, answer just this one last question. What does the gospel of Jesus Christ mean to you today?
What does the gospel of Jesus Christ mean to me today? that well, one of the things that I changed in my viewpoint of from when I was in 1998, I read a book by Philip Yancey called What's Amazing About Grace. And it challenged at the time and allowed me to move from a you can lose your salvation theology, that's how I was raised, in the Nazarene Church, to an eternal security salvation. And allowed me to learn a lot more about the love of God, grace, and things like that. It's just the love of God is very powerful, and the gospel of Christ means a lot more to me in that I am a lot more transparent. I understand myself a lot more. And so I'm able to allow God to work in my life. And it meant something, it meant a lot to me back then. But I still have to go through life. It's amazing what happens when you've gone through some things that really do bring you to the bottom of yourself. You go from intellectually understanding things and spiritually kind of grasping the tip of the iceberg of the love of God and the gospel of Christ. But then you go through life, and that really gives you a lot more substance. You're no longer just intellectually and kind of spiritually grasping it. Now it's a lot more deep, and it takes life to understand that. And so I would like, as nice as it would be able to share something that is intellectually satisfying to, say, many in the room. It is its own journey, understanding what the gospel of Jesus Christ is. It's a deeply personal and introspective thing, and if one feels that you can only approach it intellectually, you're just grasping the tip of the iceberg. There's that introspection and that really opening up yourself that you have to take hold of to go any deeper. You may feel that you understand what the gospel of Jesus Christ is, but you really got to approach it with your life. And you have to sometimes leave just purely analyzing and evaluating at the door. It's like an attitude is almost as important as what you learn, how you go into something. If you feel like you already understand it enough, or you've been there, you know how Christians are, been there, done that, then you're only going to get so much. And so I would say that what I went through growing up as a Christian, then stepping outside of the church for technically 10 years of my life, and then this year and a half or so journey back, has given me a very sobering view of what it means that as much as I wish that I could communicate with people, it's a road that each person has to take. I hope that my life does communicate how the gospel of Jesus Christ is now resonating in the verses before.
Right. So as a minister of the gospel, I speak with a lot of Christians, and a lot of Christians will use sort of as a catchphrase the gospel or the gospel of Jesus Christ. And from time to time, a fellow Christian will ask me, can you succinctly tell me what the gospel is? So I was wondering if you could do that for me as a fellow Christian, just like in three sentences or less, what is the gospel? What is the gospel of Jesus Christ?
Sentence one. That there's nothing you can do to make God love you more, and there's nothing you can do to make God love you less. That it has nothing to do with who you are, has to do with what God has done for you. And so many of us will ask, well, that's unconditional. I don't live in an unconditional world. But it is unconditional, and Christ wants us to receive it and to come as we are and to receive what's the gospel of Christ, which is free. I know that's profoundly simple, but it's also profoundly deep. And again, it requires one coming to it with their life, with an attitude of seeking, and not just merely their intellect, which is something I guess I needed to learn a certain way.
But what is it, Tom? What is the gospel? You've given me the qualifications, and you've given me the context, but what is the gospel of Jesus Christ?
That Christ has died on the cross for our sins, and that that we are fallen, and that only when we accept his gift of what he did on the cross for us, that we can have eternal life with him.
All right, do you have your questions ready? Yeah, if you would be so bold to, before you ask your question, just tell us in one phrase your relationship, if any, to Tom. Like, Tom is my old atheist friend. Or, Tom is my new Christian friend. Or, I don't know Tom from a hole in the ground. Just let us know if you have any relationship to Tom. That way we'll keep it real friendly. Go ahead, Scott.
I'm Scott Turner. I have no relationship with Tom at all. Other than, I guess, Brother in Christ. So my question, you're aware of the 5 points of Calvinism and the concept of once saved, always saved. I was wondering, do you believe that, the once saved, always saved?
That's the change that I went through in 2008 via that book, What's Amazing About Grace. It so gave me a new perspective on the grace of God, the love of God.
So you do feel like it was a point in time experience.
In 1998?
I'm trying to figure out how would you reconcile the that concept of once saved, always saved. Do you have any problem reconciling that with your spiritual journey, with what your journey has been?
That's a good question, and many people will be asking that question tonight. It's a good question. what I hear you saying is this, it's that you were saved when you were young, you stepped outside the church, you claimed to be an atheist, when you were outside the church, now you claim to be a Christian. Yet, back in 98, like I was saying, I moved to a once saved, always saved Christianity. What's the situation here? And that's the thing, it's once you, the work of Christ has been done in your life, that's it. You will be that lost sheep. You will stray from time to time. And Scripture says Christ will leave the 100 and go running after you to retrieve the sheep that is lost. And And so I would say that I had some emotional and intellectual conclusions that of being an atheist. But it's a huge question of can one be innately innately and fundamentally an atheist if they were a sincere had a sincere relationship with God, really truly felt like they accepted the Lord into their heart when they were younger. So that's the big question. And I feel that you could say that I've always been, that I have always been a Christian. What I did label myself as an atheist. And there's a lot of things that go into why I came to those conclusions. A lot of it was out of disappointment of not finding the answers that I wanted to find. Well, a lot of us will kind of understand that in our own lives that sometimes you don't get the answers you want when you want. At least maybe you still got to live, live life to come to some of those conclusions. But that's my best answer to your...
Right. Another question in the room. Is that Andy?
It is. I only know of Tom from when he spoke for the atheist position in 2011 during a debate in TMB Bible College. My question is, it sounds like Christianity has been able to meet your emotional, spiritual, and relational needs, but how does that provide evidence that its dogmatic claims are true?
That's a good question. You ready for that one?
Can you specify that a little bit more, as be more succinct with that?
Well, it's wonderful that it's been able to fulfill a lot of these needs that I think every individual needs to be happy, but just because it makes you feel good or fulfilled doesn't necessarily make it a true belief.
Okay. Like you said, it's a good question. Well, one of the things that I found myself that I raised as a standard for myself when I was a secularist was that if the conclusions were intellectually satisfying, then that was good enough. But there are it's more than just like you mentioned earlier. There are two viewpoints that we each have in our lives that we see reality through, or we look for truth through. One is our naturalist, objective view of reality. Another is our metaphysical view of reality. So as an atheist, back then, I was mainly dealing with my objective naturalist view of reality, and I was doing nothing to feed my metaphysical understanding of reality. And so now in my life, I am feeding that part of that metaphysical view. Science can't really do much to provide answers to those. Science deals far more with biology and a reductionist view and breaking things down. But when it comes to things that are abstract and things that, like love, faith, spirituality, science doesn't have much of a place in those areas. So I can't give you scientific evidence for those things, but it still is a fundamental part of who we are. We have our metaphysical needs. We have our spiritual needs, and that's what is intellectually not satisfying about it. It's not quantifiable, you can't reduce it, but it is nevertheless just as much of a reality and resonates in many of us as does biology.
All right, another question back here. I'm sorry, I don't know your name.
Me?
Yes, you.
Aaron, I do not know Tom. First time here, also. I'm just wondering whether few minutes late, maybe you addressed this during your atheist phase. Was that a dialectic that, you know, God does not exist versus exists, you know, that kind of yes, no choice? Or was it more of an intuitive, you knew God exists, but it was a matter of theology that you didn't agree with?
Could you repeat the question, please, Nathan?
Right, she's wondering whether Tom's brand of secularism was a true classic atheism, where he concluded that God does not exist, as opposed to, well, God may exist, but I have a lot of theological problems and other problems between me and that existence. Is that about right?
I was passionately pursuing evidence. An example of that is that I would step outside of the church. I wanted to be as neutral as is possible. And I wanted to really get to the bottom of what was truth. I felt at the time that I had enough evidence that there really wasn't any evidence for the Christian God of the Bible. I didn't, a lot of my searching and the inquiries didn't have to do with any other God, theistic God, but I considered myself at the time as definitely an atheist of the Christian God of the Bible. I was pretty confident, but again, I was only intellectually approaching the whole thing. There was so much more that needed to be unraveled and learned in my life that in itself, goes into answering such a question. So intellectually, I really thought I was a real atheist.
Yeah, Bernie?
Okay, I'm a good friend of Tom's. I think as an atheist, you would have said that the couple of major stories in the Bible are myth. That is the creation of humans, Adam and Eve, and also the Noah's Ark story. And there's some Christians also who say it's a myth, but it has a theological story to it. So I'm wondering, do you still think those are myths, or do you think they are literally true in some way? For example, the worldwide, or Noah's Ark, was that a global flood, a local flood, or a myth?
See, there's a decision that I'm making when approaching the Bible now in my relationship with God. And it's not to approach the Bible in a literal historical sense and to want to understand scientifically how Genesis came about. It's my focus right now to get things out of the Bible through my relationship with God and let the Bible speak to me as a narrative and as God's word. As truth. So I'm not in that area of analyzing those things. But just gaining a spiritual being fed spiritually from that. Does that answer your question?
So you're saying you don't care whether it's a true story or not? Is what you're saying?
I'm not focused on whether or not there's evidence for the ark, the flood, how Genesis corresponds with science and the Big Bang. That's an example of how I'm where I'm at in my life. One of the things that a lot of people might think that could be a possible cop out for believers and not really getting much into the sciences and really analytically looking at the Bible in a certain way is that they're not willing to entertain those things. But so on the surface, that appears to be the situation, to be maybe how Christians feel. But so much energy and effort goes into the spiritual side. It takes one's life, it takes one's time. And if a Christian has time in addition to that to also be getting into science, then they do. But the same can be said for the atheist, that the atheist does not spend most of their time just analyzing and looking at things through science, but is there time spent in introspection in really understanding yourself on an emotional, psychological level, and looking at what reasons, even psychologically, that you are an atheist. Does one spend time looking at those things?
All right, some of them over here. How about the gentleman who's just a year or two older than me there? Yes, you.
I'm Jim Cook, and I don't know, I did see the video that was posted. I was just wondering, this particular video gave me the impression that almost like that you were a divinity student and that you were basically giving a divinity student's impression of atheism. Tonight, I think you were being a lot more frank, and you were probably telling the true story about your sojourn from the church, and that it seemed much more genuine tonight. So I was just wondering, did you feel that you were sort of like acting in someone else's place when you're sort of like representing atheism? You know, this guy, myself as an atheist, I had to struggle theologically with all the, I wasn't a natural born atheist like me. And I had to struggle theologically with all my beliefs before I left the church. And then afterwards, it was very easy to keep my distance because of the suffering I had to go through. And I was just wondering, did you have any, it sounds to me like your position was quite different from that. So you were working from both positions analytically at the same time. So like, what's your comment?
Nathan, can you repeat that for...
Right. What he's wondering is, during those years that Tom was an atheist, was he, in a sense, sort of acting to be an atheist, sort of retaining some Christian worldview tenets, struggling with those internally, but putting a bold atheist front to it and presentation? Is that about right?
Well, I didn't get the impression it was putting a pretty bold atheist front. I got the impression that he had one foot in the non-believer camp, and then another foot in the divinity.
So was there a period in your past where you would say, I'm all in as an atheist? Or did you like keep at least the big toe in the Christian camp?
See, there's just so much context that surrounds your question, so much that would need to be unpackaged to truly do justice to what you're saying. For example, it was the Canby event at Canby Bible Church, or Canby Bible College, excuse me. And it was on, can you find meaning in your life? Can you make meaning in your life? And there was the Christian perspective of that, and there was the atheist, that was the atheist. And I felt that I was zeroing in as an atheist at the time on how you truly can make meaning in your life, yet it's complicated because I was intellectually doing a presentation on something that requires more than intellect. It requires your emotions. It requires your introspection. It requires really taking a real assessment of your life, really looking at where you aren't, where you're not fulfilled, where you still are restless. And that's what, that there's so much that was packed into that, that topic that night. And so I guess that in itself is an answer to your question, is that I was intellectually looking at it, and I felt I was getting a certain amount of satisfaction in creating meaning in your life. In fact, at that time, I was now participating with Bernie Deller in a meetup that was originally in CFI Portland, but they eventually moved out of CFI Portland as a meetup, dealing with naturalism, spirituality, finding meaning in your life. And it was an answer to that we needed to dig deeper, that we, it was just that we were only intellectually approaching things as atheists. So again, that's a very difficult question. I really sincerely did feel that I was approaching things as an atheist. I didn't feel that I was working from a script, or that it was that it didn't feel real. Now that in this last year and a half, I have learned so much about myself, so much that if you don't have the right attitude, if you're not actually wanting to look for something, if you're not acknowledging what your deeper needs are, then one can be content just drawing a circle of inquiry around themselves and only being interested in these topics. But it's that taking that step of looking at those topics outside of that circle of inquiry that may be abstract, that might be messy, that aren't exactly quantifiable, but again, are a very important reality resonating with most of us. So I don't know if that's an answer to your question, but.
Yeah, I think you started to approach that, and I was just noticing the ambiguity that was there, and of course that was natural because of the strength of where you were coming from.
Yes, over here.
Are you asking if I approached those type of books while I was an atheist?
At any time. Have you ever examined those books and thought about if they're making a valid argument for Christ's claim?
Did you all hear that question? She's asking about several best-selling apologetics books, Lee Strobel's book, The Case for Christ, or C.S. Lewis's book, Mere Christianity, or Josh McDowell's book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict. Did you read any of these? Were they compelling to you? What do you think?
Well, that was definitely my modus operandi. Leading up to my stepping outside the church, and while I was in the secular realm, I read a lot of books. I even led one of Powell's City of Books book groups, a free thinkers book group, and we did take a couple Christian books, not Mere Christianity, but we took one that touched upon C.S. Lewis. There was a lot of books that I read that were a part of those. Again, it depends on the attitude that you approach a lot of these with. And if you're willing to really inquire into more than is there's a logical fallacy going on here, or are they communicating things properly? There's just a lot that goes into it. When I was in the book group, there were, even though it was all secularists who were, you know, smart, there was as many opinions as people in the book group, and it showed me that there is a real tendency, believer or not, to agree with the majority, to go along with what is the popular opinion of something. It's not as popular to forge your own trail and to really know who you are and what your thoughts are about these things. It's not as popular. You won't get as many conversations from people about those things. So that was definitely one of the things that I encountered when I was in the secular realm, is that you don't have to be religious to be dogmatic or to be ideological or to want to prefer one conclusion over another. It just appears that I would argue that Christians have some of their tend to have some of their biases in one certain areas, and secularists tend to have their biases in other areas. But we all, have our biases.
All right, Patrick.
I'd like to say I'm a friend of Tom from the atheist days, maybe friendly acquaintance or somewhere in between. But we had good times together. I'd like to ask, the Christianity, is it a belief that is working for you and right for you, or is it a fact that a non-believer like myself or an other believer like a Buddhist is rejecting to his own harm?
It's a belief that's working for me and right for me.
Thank you.
That's the short answer. But there are, you know, a lot of facets to it. It resonates for me because it's always been there. That's an argument tonight. Does one ever really truly walk away from their faith, or does aspects of it, does the Holy Spirit stay there? And is it like a homecoming? You just simply left home, you know, and you wander on your own road inquiry, and then you come back, and you feel like you truly are returning to your roots. You can't exactly explain it, but you know that you are moving in the right direction.
Can I follow up a bit on that?
Sure, Patrick.
Because let's say myself, I have found, leaving a very devout, a lifelong devout Christianity, that my conscience remained alive and well. For you, it is the Holy Spirit still dealing with me. For me, it's nature and nurture hardwired my brain to, like I'm in a beer store buying beer, craft beer, expensive craft beer, and the clerk gets it wrong. He gets it like 1/4 of the real price, and I correct him. I say, no, just something inside me makes me do that. To me, it's the way I've been, what I inherited and what I've been trained, but from your point of view, I can see where it would still be, something is still dealing with me. That's a comment I'd like to throw in.
Thank you. Yes, is it Laura?
Yes, it is. I'm Laura Roberts. Tom and I have probably known each other for maybe 2 or 3 years ago. As a Christian, I've had the privilege to be able to kind of walk alongside of him at times during this transition as well. I thank you for that. I thank you for doing this for tonight as well. But now I'm going to ask a question that will maybe sound a little more controversial. If I was a secular humanist, or if I didn't know you, and if I was driving home tonight, I perhaps would have the impression that you have made this transition only to fulfill psychological and social needs. Would that be the accurate impression? And if so, why or why not?
So Laura's asking Tom to give us a little bit more information on whether or not his conversion or move back to Christianity is merely to meet psychological, emotional, relational needs, or is there something more to it than that?
Again, like I was mentioning, is that there are psychological and emotional needs because it's a part of the whole person. When you're moving towards something, you're moving with all of yourself in that direction, and so you're getting benefited on many levels. But it is, I think it's something that profoundly speaks for itself, that it was my intention to create a worldview for myself when I, you know, gradually over the years, when I came to understanding myself as wanting to be in the camp of an atheist, it was my intention over the years to find a worldview that was intellectually, emotionally, everything satisfying, that answered all the deep questions. And I read a lot of books and studied a lot of things, but when I really had to ask myself the question in like 2011, how am I going to live out the rest of my life in a way that is deeply fulfilling, I found that my worldview really didn't answer that. It really didn't have much substance for that. I came to realize that my worldview did not have much of an answer for me when there is no quick fix-it solution in life. When there are situations where hope is removed from you, where control is taken from you, and you need, and your intellectual understanding of reality, biology, why we do what we do, does not it does not come to really help you. So it was a profound, it was a very sobering realization that I had something that, a worldview that only scratched the tip of the iceberg of what I really needed to search, that it didn't do what I thought it would do. And this allowed and forced me, you could say, to start looking at the relevance of church again, looking at the relevance of prayer, a relationship with God, that there's something profound about those things that addressed deep new things in me, that my secular worldview could not address. On the surface of it, on the face of it, it would appear that one is just fulfilling that I was just fulfilling my emotional and psychological needs. But again, I'm not just, is not just a presentation, it's an interview of a personal journey. One that it's hard to write those things in essay form, to really convey to you what I had to walk through to come to these conclusions. And many people know me that I will debate with the best of them. I'm very analytical. I will latch onto an idea until I feel like I understand it. I will not lose a debate. So that's very off character for what people understood about me. And that truly speaks to that something really did happen, that I really wasn't just looking for a quick emotional or psychological fix, but that I was moved in a direction almost basically inevitably, because I'm still on that journey, still walking down that road. Something I don't think that, in all true respect, a lot of, I feel, my secular friends were doing. I didn't feel that they were on a similar type of road of inquiry that I was on, because I was also willing to entertain subjects in psychology. I was also willing to entertain a spiritual need that people have. I was also willing to entertain and inquire into things that are abstract and are a little messy, but again, are important to us.
All right, now we got a lot of questions. Yes, sir, in the blue.
Just sort of hitting on what the pastor said earlier, I think people sort of conceptualize where you're coming from, whether they agree or not, that you found something in a spiritual tradition that atheism or materialism doesn't have. But did you find anything unique in Christianity that would not exist in, say, Buddhism or some other tradition that's not materialistic and may have a spiritual look on reality? Why would Christianity, why not just in one of those options, why Christianity?
Well, I don't have a very good answer for that. I'm just being authentic and true to my journey. That's a great question. It would require me to really compare and contrast Buddhism and Christianity more. But it is was being true to myself. It was truly returning to my roots. But not just wanting to return to tradition, because I left Christianity in the first place because I did not like the hypocrisy and dogmatic nature of many people that I knew then. I did not want to just be traditional. I didn't just want to be cultural. I wanted something that was authentic. So I'll have to look into more of that. Thank you for giving me a subject to maybe look into. Yeah.
Well, get ready to meet more hypocrites now that you're back in the church. Hey, Richard, you got a question?
No, I was just trying to get you to repeat.
Would you like to do that after the fact?
Pardon?
Were you able to figure out the question? Or?
Well, I'm acting on the behalf of other people in the room.
Right. The question was, why didn't you do a search, comparative religious study, to find out, you know, the best religion for you? And Tom is saying, well, he just went back to what he was raised in, what he knew to be the Christian faith. Yeah. I'll take your question just, but first I want to see if there's someone who hasn't asked a question. Gavin, to the office, please.
I just have a real easy one for you to answer, as long as it doesn't make you feel uncomfortable. When, before you considered yourself an atheist, what denomination of Christianity were you, and what denomination of Christianity are you now?
Gavin, who's been in several denominations and several religions, would like to know.
Not part of them, just visiting.
Not part, just visiting, member, card-carrying member, but knows a lot about a lot of us, would like to know what you were a part of before.
I was raised in the Church of the Nazarene growing up. That's a holiness denomination church, very Bible-based. But you also had the you can lose yourself theology, doctrine to it. And now I do attend a Baptist church, which is definitely different from that in terms of a much fuller understanding of the love of God, that there really is nothing that can separate you from God's love. And there's less of a conditional element to it.
Thank you.
Right. Larry.
Well, first, I appreciate you coming and sitting under the spotlight to answer all these questions. And I appreciate your journey as one who's on it as well. The question I have relates to what I could see could possibly be considered this dichotomy. In order to return to your roots and embrace the Christian faith again, you had to divorce yourself from all this analytical side. Do you feel like, you know, you're schizophrenic, or you're dealing with things like that? Do you have to divorce yourself of, you know, empirical, you know, knowledge and information, things like that, to believe?
Maybe you can touch on that. So Larry's question is, you know, to make this return to Christianity, did you just pursue the metaphysical and trash your objective naturalist pursuit? Or I think a number of us are sort of like asking that question tonight. I think secularists in the room, Christians in the room, we're all rather concerned about how you've made this decision.
If I'm going to get split personality disorder, isn't
yeah.
I?
Yeah.
Very good question. On the surface of it, it appears that I'm putting less value into my intellectual inquiries, analyzing things, the scientific method, objectively looking at stuff. But what's really taking place is I'm putting far more of my energy, investing far more of my energy and focus and values into my spiritual, my metaphysical, the metaphysical questions in my life and my relationship with God. And so that I do end up, in, as a result, prioritizing what I will focus on, what I will put my energy into. It doesn't make me less, according to maybe some secularists who may argue, therefore less rational. An example of someone who has a very healthy mind, a very rational scientific mind, but also one who entertains belief and has a real relationship with God. An example of that would be Francis Collins. He's head of the National Genome Project. He was awarded a Medal of Honor, the Presidential Medal for his work in science. And he has a very lucid, scientific mind, but it's something that he has testified about. He also is an evangelical and has a relationship with God. He doesn't merely look at God, he's not like a deist, or he doesn't necessarily have an old earth Christianity that I know of, but his mind very nicely entertains his scientific understanding, but also his belief and his need for God. So where a lot of people would say there is a cognitive dissonance going on there, he has found harmony in that. It's just that he probably adheres to, I'm guessing, what Stephen Jay Gould, who is a scientist, referred to as the non-overlapping magisteria. And what that is, sorry for the technical terms, is that There's a domain in science that should not interfere with the domain of religion and faith. That science answers scientific questions and religion answers, Christianity answers its questions. And that the two should not overlap because they don't have much to do with each other. But that they still are how the mind's been designed. It's been designed for discovery and inquiry, but there's also an aspect of the mind that has a need for faith and for belief.
So now, Tom, with that answer, is rolling us into another two-hour discussion. So how are you all doing on time? You know, we have just whittled away an entire hour. Are you okay with that? Yeah, in just a few minutes, we're going to allow people to escape. Actually, you can go anytime you want, but I am going to have to officially close the forum just in a few minutes. And then you're welcome to stay in this room as long as you want tonight. I don't know how long you're planning to stay, Tom, but you can also informally talk with Tom or myself or with each other longer. But let's just take a few more questions. Let's see here. Yes, right in the front.
Hi. I don't know, Tom. My question, it sounds like you have come to the conclusion that the metaphysical was one of your biggest problems and then therefore fulfillment of Christianity and the lack of scientific evidence for the metaphysical. I'm just curious as to your processing, your very passionate exploration, if you've ever studied things like the dog pack and the survival of the fittest and the cognitive functioning and psychology and how it connects to chemicals in the brain and stuff like that. I'm just curious as of, like, you've seemed to kind of narrow it down to the metaphysical having issues with science, but I definitely don't see that, so I'm wondering how much your exploration includes all of that.
So she's wondering if Tom is doing some exploration concerning cognitive function, the dog pack, survival of the fittest. What are you doing about these, Tom?
Well, I did. I inquired into all those things. I was definitely into evolutionary biology and how we evolve certain traits and how we were pack animals, and that at a certain point in our evolutionary history, we went from moving from being a part of the herd to recognizing ourselves, becoming self-consciously aware. How there are many theories as to how that happens. And again, that was what I was studying back then. I covered all the bases. I wanted to be extremely serious about why I can indeed say with conviction that there was no God. You know, it was my intention. But when I noticed that those answers, the data, the information that I had, was just, there were conclusions. There's a couple of things about science, the realities about science that one must keep in mind while they are freely inquiring through science. One is that science never claims to know anything with absolute certainty. Another one is that scientific theories are contingent, meaning that they're subject to change, and that any theory may lack some information that could make it more complete, that there's always something to learn. And so, something I realized and learned as I was moving down this road is that I was taking that foundation and trying to apply those conclusions to deep questions that I was trying to take that foundation and turn it into my own hope, turn it into something that I could basically have faith in, you could say, something that I would be content with living out the rest of my life with that worldview. But Science, again, like I mentioned with Stephen Jay Gould, not an overriding magisterium. Science only addresses certain things, and its domain doesn't really have much to do with certain, with our other needs that we have.
All right, Charlie?
Yeah, I'm not well acquainted with Tom, but I've participated in these forums several times, and I think we've had several conversations together. You mentioned, Tom, that as a young person you were involved in evangelistic and missions activities. So my questions to you are, as an atheist, did it bother you that you had spent time trying to bring people to faith in Christ? And now that you're a Christian today, does it concern you that you spent time and effort working to convince people of atheism?
Do you want me to really repeat that? Yeah, Charlie's wondering if Tom is having any kind of personal crisis about being an evangelist for Christianity and then an evangelist for atheism, and now with the prospect of being an evangelist for Christianity.
There were some things that I wasn't very proud of when I, the Christianity that I had before I left the church, aspects of, but that had more to do with the theology that I believed back then, that you can lose your salvation. Theology. I remember pressuring some people into wanting to believe in God because I brought more up that, Christ could come back at any moment, and more of a fear factor. And that's what comes with that theology that you can lose your salvation is that conditional fear of punishment element. And with that, that can encourage some behavior that when one looks back, now having a better grasp and understanding of God's love, that you're not proud of. As far as the atheist element, I think I took a lot of some of my witnessing skills when I was a Christian and kind of applied them, used them when I socialized with people as an atheist. I know that Bernie was in full control of where he was going, what he was inquiring to, but I would like to say that I encouraged Bernie to move from Christianity to atheism. I
know he's taking credit, Bernie.
I know that he won't say that I was responsible for that, but I definitely had a lot of deep conversations. And as I'm learning more about myself, I wish I knew more of myself when I was trying to encourage Christians to have doubts about their Christianity. So I do regret that.
All right, one more in the back. I'm so sorry to cut some of you off, but it'll have to go to informal conversation.
Well, I was in Tom's book club, and he is a real gentleman, and I appreciated Tom urging the atheists not to get too outspoken against Christianity and things. I appreciate it. I guess the things I have is, I notice you say you've gone to you're a Baptist now. I guess one thing that bothers me is you say that being religious gives you a different worldview. I guess the thing that bothers me about Baptists, and maybe I'm wrong, but specifically Thomas Jefferson had his wall of separation of church and state document too, of the Danbury Baptist group, and that's when they were a small minority. Now it seems to me, now that they've gotten into power, I think separation of church and state is probably the last thing in their agenda. And I don't know if you talk to that at all. But I guess the one thing that bothers me is I understand Baptist is the concept of an eternal hellfire and an eternal, infinite amount of punishment for a very finite, short piece of life we have here. I'm just wondering how I'm like you. My father was a minister. I've been a Christian most of my life, and I just haven't gone back. see it, there's just hundreds of problems rather than giving it this ignoring.
Wow, so we're going to end on this one. What do you think about the teaching of eternal punishment for such a short lifespan of rebellion or basic goodness?
Well, I'm going to give an answer that may not be, again, intellectually satisfying to maybe some. One is because I am focused, the way that I am focused, where I'm at in my life right now, just getting closer to God, worrying about these things. I did not move back into Christianity and by doing a, which it's reasonable to do, by doing an exhaustive evaluation of what I was getting back into, really looking at things such as what you're talking about, the Baptist view of hell. And that will happen as I go down the road more. But it's being true to my needs, being true to what was driving me and pulling me, and so being true to myself. But we all want to be happy. We want to go through our life in a way that we honestly respect. And for me, moving towards what I needed in my life and back to God, as much as I tried with the secular approach, it was what ultimately I needed. And a lot of people, where they enter into Christianity or they leave Christianity because they researched and looked into how things didn't hold up under their own merit. That's one way to do it. But a consequence of only approaching things through a researching, evaluating a type of perspective is that you may be leaving out other aspects of what you can be learning, what you can be inquiring into. It becomes very easy to just analyze and evaluate things. And I feel that the attitude that one takes when they are learning and growing is just as important as them evaluating and analyzing things. Because you can be very smart and analyze and evaluate things and maybe find them wanting or just repugnant. But if you're also doing it with a certain attitude, and that you're not willing to grow and change, or you feel that you already understand enough of something, and so you have an intention to disprove something. And we've all been guilty of that. It's therefore easy to be biased because you have an end goal in mind. You're not being transparent and vulnerable the way that you should, and being humble enough to accept, or I was not, being humble enough to accept that maybe there was more that I could learn, more that I could grow in. And that's exactly what I've done over this last year and a half. That has been made all the difference in how far I've grown.
Great. Well, thank you for your participation tonight, and you are welcome to stay later. Hey, before we leave, oftentimes in our communities, when someone converts from one position or one worldview to another, it usually means that the former group he was a part of or she was a part of shuns, ignores, or turns off. And probably a good number of us in the room have either experienced this or we've been a part of it. On one side or the other, or we've heard about it. And if you care about Tom, regardless of your worldview, I would like to encourage you to keep contact with him, even if you just do so online. Like if you are an atheist, and you're as concerned as I am tonight about Tom's unfolding life not being as crisp as we would like it to be, this is your opportunity as an atheist to interact with him and tell him, he's just missing the boat by not keeping his naturalist self and perspective alive, as, and just going whole hog into metaphysics. If If we're going to make the religion forum or any other effort in our community work toward making us good neighbors, where we are strong enough and graceful enough to interact across lines, then this is really, Tom gives to us perhaps, I think, the best opportunity we've had in these past several years to cross a line. Because Tom is quite likable. I think you've picked up on that. He won't even tell his good friend from the book club that he's going to hell, see? You were not satisfied with that answer, were you?
No.
No, you were not satisfied. So I would encourage you to somehow keep your connection to Tom and say, buddy, you got to give me a better answer than that. And work through it if you care about Tom. And if you're a Christian, you may not be completely satisfied with what Tom said, except that Tom is being honest and saying, this is where I'm at. And so then as a Christian, you have an opportunity to engage him. And see, then we're actually being a community. That now we are ending the polarization. So I I'm a preacher, so I just had to get my sermon. But make sure that Tom knows how much you care about him tonight. Thank you so much, Tom, for sharing your story. Thank you so much. Being here, and thank you for asking some really fine questions. They really made the conversation great.